The French are so damn chic. I salute you from the red carpet. You are just amazing. You're also very short, but nonetheless, well, Napoleon drowned when a dog peed on him, but that's not the point. I have gained 12 pounds, and some lady before said, you look good, because I hate thin, we're talking about, I hate thin people. Let's just start with that. Thank God, the front row, chubettes. I'm very happy. You look good. By the way, I also, just so you know, when I said I don't like thin people, I also hate fat people. I hate fat people. I now belong to Overeaters Anonymous, so I don't get that, which is hilarious to call themselves anonymous. Let's be 15 women walking in 400 pounds. Nobody's noticed? They're all wearing T-shirts that say, save the whales for breakfast. It is just... And they cry. They sit and they cry. Nobody loves me. I said, that's not true. Your butcher loves you. Your baker loves you. Is that true? What a nice audience you are. A nice young audience, which would make my friend Cher very happy. She loves young men. Certain women, what do they call them? Cougars, right? Do you know what I'm talking about? They love young. Cher hangs out at Toys R Us. It is just... It's wrong. Do you know what I'm saying? What if you're kissing someone and you think, I wonder what happened to that boy I gave away 28 years ago? It's just... But I also, which really screws me, I hate older men too. Older men, the balls on the ground, come on. They try to look neat, they tuck them into their socks. I hate old men. One guy I went out with, he gave me a hickey, he left his teeth in my neck. It was terrible. Terrible. Another guy said, I want you to meet my family. He took me to the cemetery. Well, it was like... And their pickup lines, you go to a bar and an old guy come over, hello, do I come here often? I mean, they are just...
The crowd goes wild.
They must know something we don't know, no, like I'm gonna die, you know what I mean? No.
Seriously, I cannot walk down the stairs. You go.
Can I help you here?
But you know what would be nice if tonight I died on your show, because they would get to see a show and a death for the rest of your lives, audience. You would go to dinner parties, they'd say, you were there?
Seriously, I cannot walk down the stairs. You go.
Can I help you here?
But you know what would be nice if tonight I died on your show, because they would get to see a show.
Seriously, I cannot walk down the stairs. You go. Can I help?
They like to poke fun at current events. It's a forever evolving and a must-see for anyone visiting San Francisco. It's an institution. Please welcome Joe Schumann-Silver and Raina Wilson. Ladies, welcome.
Hi, thanks.
Good to have you on board.
Thank you.
We already did the show, so we don't need to talk.
I don't know, have anything else to say.
Well, let's start with, you're in your 38th year.
Yes.
On a show. That is just remarkable. Why is it just lasted so long and it keeps getting better?
Because Steve Silver created this amazing thing to last. And we're just running it as if Steve Silver was here. It's very updated all the time. So I said Barry Zito, when he hit the no-hitter, he was in the show that night. If there's something in the news this morning, if I looked here and saw something in the news, I'd put it in the show that night. And it's just always current and always evolving. Plus, you have the best time. It's visually beautiful. There's big cats, great costumes, great singing. The talent is amazing. It's just a great show.
He's the host of The World According to Jesse and former Minnesota governor. And you may be surprised to know that although he and I are both seen here on RT America, and Governor, you've appeared on my show from another location.
Sure.
It may surprise people watching to know that you and I just met in person for the first time today when our schedules finally aligned. Welcome.
Thank you. And Holland, it's wonderful to finally meet you. You got a great show. As you know, I'm out here right now in D.C. momentarily.
The swamp.
The swamp. I'm out here in the swamp for a couple of days, so I did a few shows out here and did a few interviews out here. And I need to get back here now and then, but I'm fortunate enough with RT that they've set me up to where I can do my show in my home city of Minneapolis, St. Paul, Minnesota. So I've often bragged, I think I have the greatest job in the world right now.
Yep, working at home. Well, since you mentioned the swamp, you met Donald Trump years ago. Is it my imagination, or does Trump's act bear more than a slight resemblance to your unconventional campaign for governor 21 years ago?
Well, it does in a way. Now, I initially met Donald Trump, the president, at WrestleMania 4 and 5, I think. He was hosting at his place in Atlantic City, and that was back in the late 80s. Then when I ran for governor in 98 and won, Donald Trump flew out and met with me. And we had a good time meeting each other. In fact, later on, I had dinner with him years later in New York. He could have sold tickets to it. You know who was at dinner? Donald Trump, Jesse Ventura, and Woody Harrelson. He'd sell tickets to that. So anyway, I've known Donald Trump for many, many years, and he always rattled his sword that he was going to do it. That's why I never believed it. I didn't believe in 2016 that he would follow through, because he'd been rattling his sword about it for over 20 years. Now, what did he take from me? Here's what he took from my campaign. We didn't do fundraising because I only raised $300,000 to become the governor of Minnesota. I didn't care about raising money.
Against millions from two other
candidates. $12 million is what the Dems and Repubs spent to try to win, and I won and only spent $300,000, actually made more money than what I spent to get the job. But what Trump learned from me was that don't go out to fundraise, have rallies. And if you watched his campaign for president, he was going to rallies, 10,000 people showing up in an airport hangar, this rally, that rally. See, if someone shows up at a rally for you, you can take it to the bank pretty well. They're going to vote for you. So while Hillary was out doing these 150 people money grab,
yeah.
Donald Trump was out performing
yep.
in front of 10,000 people. He ended up ultimately winning. And that's what he took from my playbook, I think, the most.
That's gotta be Kane! That's gotta be Kane! Oh my God, he just ripped the door off its hinges!
Take Lita to be your wife.
I do.
And you can kiss the bride.
This coming Friday, May 1st, brings a host of changes for states and cities as many of the original stay-at-home orders expire. Some states are extending those orders, while others, like Tennessee, are already reopening their economies with limitations. And then, within those states, there are cities and counties, like Knox County, Tennessee, setting their own schedules, balancing the health of their citizens with the need to get business owners back on their feet. Glenn Jacobs is the mayor of Knox County and joins us now. Mr. Mayor, thank you so much for your time. It's a tough call. Right, so you have a three-point reopening plan, a phase plan. People must keep social distancing, wear their masks. High-risk people should stay at home. But you also think it's time to reopen businesses, daycare centers, spas, restaurants, salons, retail stores, gyms, places of worships. I know you. I follow you on Twitter. I know you think it's important. You can't keep the economy dormant so long. What is your test for is this safe enough? What are you going to watch?
Well, our health department actually implements these plans, and this plan is put together with the joint task force with the city of Knoxville, officials from Knox County, as well as the Knox County Health Department. And they have metrics that they will look at going forward. As you said, you know, we can't keep the economy dormant. A lot of people are suffering. 27 million Americans have lost their jobs over the past 5 weeks. Here in Tennessee, we've had 400,000 people file for unemployment. I'm concerned that we're going to reach a point when we talk about reopening the economy, there's not going to be much left to reopen. So we have to do so, of course, in a safe manner.
You have a unique perspective. Forgive me, Mr. Mayor, but my son knows you as Kane. You're a professional wrestler. You're a professional wrestler, an athlete, and a performer who has to get up close and personal in a very close, tight space, sometimes with one, sometimes with a lot more than one. You're also a small business owner who wants to get your own business back up and running, but you have employees to worry about. And you're a mayor who has to worry about the decisions of all the people. You make a decision that could impact the health and safety and the economic well-being of somebody else. Take us through this personal.
You know he's a fierce competitor, but you've never seen Donald Trump fight like this.
Hey, look at this! Donald Trump! Donald Trump!
It's Trump the Thumper.
Oh my God! a hostile takeover of Donald Trump on Vince McMahon.
We've uncovered lost footage of the presidential candidate back in 2007 at WrestleMania 23 taking on WWE boss Vince McMahon.
It is time for the Battle of the Billionaires.
The live pay-per-view event took place in front of 85,000 screaming wrestling fans, including Trump's beauty queens, Miss Teen USA, Miss USA, and Miss Universe. Wrestler Bobby Lashley was Trump's partner that day.
Man, the crowd went insane.
He says it was Trump's idea to take down McMahon.
He just wanted to play more of an active role in it. And I think that part where he took down Vince and kind of gave him a couple knuckles was just him having a little fun with it.
Yes, it is! Lashley wins!
Trump won the match.
Oh, no!
And to the victor goes the Clipper. He got to shave Vince McMahon bald. Fast forward 9 years, Trump now finds himself wrestling in a different arena and reeling from his first electoral loss.
What kind of people do we have running for office? No, it's honestly, really, really dishonest.
He's now calling.
I've heard your voices loud and clear. We have to now, we have tough choices ahead. The first choice that we must make is the one that will determine our success. Shall we rebuild our state together, or shall we fight amongst ourselves, create even deeper division, and fail the people of California? Well, let me tell you something. The answer is clear. For the people to win, politics as usual must lose.
Then tell me, future boy, who's president of the United States in 1985?
Ronald Reagan.
As they said in the film, Back to the Future, where are we going? We don't need roads.
Reagan loved the movie. We heard from the White House that when he ran the movie in the White House, he made the projection stop the movie at the reference to who's president of the United States and watch it again. He was laughing so hard he missed some of the dialogue.
Ronald Reagan, the actor? Then who's vice president? Jerry Lewis?
That title in itself is just extremely, extremely catchy. I wish.
It's a phenomenon.
Thank you.
Talking Voice believes enough is enough with the anti-Trump movement. Man won the election, give him a chance.
And now you're going to run for president. Don't you think that's a really cool idea, you guys? You'll keep them honest. You'll keep them honest, Donald. Personally, I hope you win, because I can't wait for the the inauguration.
This will be the year the American people say enough is enough. This will finally be the year the American people say enough is enough. Enough is enough.
It was the American people saying enough is enough. They're fed up.
And say enough is enough.
Say enough is enough. Enough is enough. And we do not tolerate this kind of behavior in this country.
Me, the guy who hosted The Apprentice and sold steaks. But enough is enough. It has to be stopped. It has to be stopped now.